We'll see how I do with this. Well, welcome everybody to Closing Maine's Hunger Gap. I want to start just by introducing myself and say a little bit about the food studies program that has brought this lecture to you tonight. So my name is Michael Hillard. I'm a professor of economics here and also director of USM's new food studies program, which just inaugurated in 2017. And I guess what I wanted to start with is just to talk a little bit about why we're having this series. I'm going to tell it in a sort of an autobiographical way, because a couple of years ago, I was sort of interested in some issues in the food system in Maine, mainly having to do with restaurant labor, and was given an opportunity with some other faculty and staff to build out a larger program. And in recent years, people at the university have tried to conceive of ways in which our individual programs can be part of a larger vision of being a metropolitan university, which is pretty much what it sounds like, which is really trying to integrate the university with the community so that we can enrich each other at the highest possible level. So in my 30 plus years at USM, there's often this effort of the universities over here and the communities over here, and we're going to try and make contacts and develop relationships and get to know each other and then start to figure out how we can collaborate. What was unusual about this program is that we started by linking the people in the university and community together and building out in both directions. And it's made for a very fruitful collaboration. The ethos of our program, our creed, if you will, is to do what we can through education, through policy, through research, through collaboration with the community to build environmentally sustainable and socially just food system. And it's out of that commitment that this series first grew. So in those early days when we were not actually a program but just talking to people in the community, we had a fortunate meeting with Jim Hanna, the Cumberland County Food Security Council, Kristen Malley, of Good Shepherd Food Bank, and Michelle Lamb at Preble Street's Maine Hunger Initiative. And we were talking about what we might do years down the road, and they're like, we have research that we're trying to do right now. There's a really big problem with food insecurity in the state, and the more we can do faster, the better that we can get to really addressing what is really an extensive problem. And they asked for some research assistance, so I gathered myself as a labor economist and a group of 7 graduate students in a food capitalism class I taught in the fall 2016, and we contributed to a report called Closing Maine's Hunger Gap, which our two speakers before the main speaker will discuss. What I did not know 3 years ago was that Maine is probably the worst place in the northeastern United States for the degree of food insecurity, and it's a problem that has gotten essentially worse rather than better in recent years for reasons that our speakers will discuss. And I was shocked to find that out, and it created a sense of urgency on my part and on the part of my students and my fellow faculty to see what we could do to contribute to the problem. So the first outcome of that was a report called Hunger Pains back in February, March this past year. This lecture series this fall to sort of try and frame a new and fresh discussion about the nature of food insecurity, its causes, and its solutions here in Maine. We plan to follow, this is the second of 2 lectures. We had Donna Beagle, a foremost expert on the structural problems underlying poverty and the solutions to it. And we're going to move into 2018 with further ambitions to make this issue much more squarely as a statewide factor that people are reckoning with. And we're going to do that by doing 2 things. We're going to have a policy conference late February, early March to try and set a fresh agenda for dealing with food security policy through and continuing past the 2018 election. And then secondly, to hold gubernatorial forums where the issues of food security can be debated by the candidates running for governor. So I want to say a few brief thanks and then introduce a couple of local speakers who can give a deeper perspective on where things here are in Maine. And following that, Jim Hanno, I mentioned before, a long collaborator with our Maine speaker, Mark Winne, will introduce the speaker. Some brief thanks. First of all, the Maine Economic Improvement Fund generously is funding this activity. That's why this is free and open to the public. I want to thank the food studies staff, because we've assembled a good team already that makes events like this possible. I would lead first and foremost with Lisa Marie Lindenschmidt, our administrative specialist, who was here until about 5 minutes ago and is responsible for things going smoothly tonight. Our graduate assistants, Mary Elizabeth Sims and Mary Moran, Jody Sapphire, program consultant, the faculty, the burgeoning faculty of the USM Food Studies Program. I'd also like to thank the collaborators who brought these issues to me and my colleagues here at the university, and who have and continue to be great partners, and they include Jan Bindis-Tendi, Michelle Lamb, Donna Yellen, who will speak in a moment, Jim Hanna will speak in a moment, Clara Whitney, and Kristen Malley. So with that, I would like to introduce two speakers, and I'll give the introductions to both of them, and then they'll speak in sequence about what the situation is here in Maine. First speaker is Donna Yellen. She's a social worker, and she's a chief program officer for Preble Street, a social service agency that many of you know well, that operates 13 programs throughout Maine from sites from Portland, Lewiston, and Bangor. From a nutritious meal to crisis intervention, from clean clothes to health care, from showers to a permanent home, Preble Street provides low barrier programs to empower people experiencing problems with hunger, homelessness, housing, and human trafficking, and advocates for public policies and programs that solve these problems. Our second speaker before Mark Winne is Kristen Malley. Kristen is the president of Good Shepherd Food Bank, Maine's largest hunger relief organization. Good Shepherd Food Bank works with a network of 400 nonprofit organizations to distribute 22 million meals a year throughout the state to people in need. Before her role as president, she was the founder and a program director for Cooking Maine Matters, a local chapter of Share Our Strengths nationally recognized cooking and nutrition education program for low-income families. Prior to her work with food security, she worked for over a decade in the private equity and business consulting fields. After volunteering for hunger relief organizations, she decided to make her passion for ending hunger her occupation. She received her undergraduate degree from Boston College and her master's degree in business administration from Boston University, where she studied both entrepreneurship and nonprofit management. So with that, I'll invite the first of our two opening speakers, and that is Donna Yellen of Preble Street. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael, and welcome to Maine, Mark. We're glad you're here. At Preble Street, we use food to love people. Last week, when we had the awful storm that I'm sure affected many of you, it was cold and rainy, and the people outside of the soup kitchen line battled the wind to come in and get warm, and were, as you can imagine, pretty miserable and unhappy. This was also the day that one of our walk-in coolers bit the dust, and our food program staff and faithful volunteers scrambled to make sure nothing went to waste. The cooler was full from a donation of local fish we had just received, and our kitchen staff immediately went to work making a delicious haddock chowder. That warm, nourishing haddock chowder, made with love, warmed the hearts and bellies of countless people that day. A social worker staffing the dining room told me he could see the change in people's faces and how smiles started to appear around the room as people got up and kept returning for more. He said it felt like a kitchen at home, where people were gathered and food was replenishing them and bringing joy. We use food to love people at our three soup kitchens, where we served 1,200 meals one recent day. There were 400 people at our dinner meal that evening in a room that's probably about twice the size of this one. We use food to love people in our anti-trafficking program, when caseworkers make sure that the victim of human trafficking has had lunch before we accompany her to court to testify against her trafficker. We use food to love people when our Veterans Housing Services caseworker brings a food box to a veteran's new apartment. We use food to love people when our Maine Hunger Initiative staff goes to Houston Commons or another of our Housing First apartments for chronically homeless people and signs them up for SNAP benefits. We use food to love people when our advocacy program joins with partners like USM Food Studies Program, Good Shepherd Food Bank, the Cumberland County Food Security Council, and Maine Equal Justice Partners to research, educate, and advocate for just food policy on state and national levels. There's an ancient prayer that asks to give hunger for justice to those who have bread. At Preble Street's work around the state, we see hunger in front of us every day, and we work for that justice. Shamefully, Maine has the third highest rate of hunger in the nation. One out of every five Maine children experiences food insecurity. There are more people who are food insecure in Maine than there are in the total population of Maine's six largest cities. That's a lot of people. I don't know how many people can even name the six largest cities in Maine. The Hunger Pains Report, the collaborative effort Michael mentioned between USM, Preble Street, and Good Shepherd Food Bank, came about because we incorporate advocacy into our mission. And the advocacy we do is always informed by our direct services, by talking to those we serve, by learning from those experiences. The most knowledgeable experts on poverty are those who are poor. While the rest of the country experiences recovery and relief after the recession, Maine's relative rates of hunger and poverty have worsened. Maine has made policy changes and choices to reduce access to SNAP, and so many Mainers struggle to get the food they need. We knew that to make real change, we needed to find out what was really happening in those waiting in those long lines of food pantries throughout the state. So together, we were able to collect over 2,000 surveys from food insecure Mainers in every county in the state and hold focus groups in Bridgeton, Waterville, Ellsworth, Portland, and Presque Isle. We pulled off a large-scale research study, the first of its kind in Maine. Here's a very small sample of what we found. 87% of households we talked to at food pantries contain a child, a senior, or a person with a disability. Food pantries, which were conceived as a source of emergency food assistance, have become instead a means for long-term survival for thousands of Mainers. 86% of the people we talk to have to use food pantries at least once a month to get by. 59% of those people are using pantries more this year than they did in the last year. One out of every four people we talked to were dropped from the SNAP program in the previous year. Many because of two state policy changes, the asset test and the three-month time limit for people who are struggling to find work. As an older man in Hancock County told us, if I'm working as hard as I do, I want to have the right to survive and live instead of going hungry. Now today, at the federal level, the president's proposed budget includes major slashes to the SNAP program and the tax plan being discussed will also wipe out safety net programs. This fall, we teamed up with Maine Equal Justice Partners to talk with over 400 Mainers who are participating in SNAP to understand the impact of SNAP on their well-being. We were especially interested in its impact on people living in rural areas, the elderly, people with disabilities, veterans, and working families with children. The research showed that for these Mainers, that SNAP helps them get enough to eat. Perhaps the clearest indicator of why SNAP matters to their families was the response to this question. How much help would you get from family and friends or local charities if you lost your SNAP benefits? Fully 62% said they would get very little or no help to get the food they needed. And 23% said that they would be able to get some help. A distinct minority, only 7%, said that they would get all the help they needed. Their responses painted a stark picture of what hunger in Maine would look like without SNAP, even as limited as it is. Particularly striking these findings are that many Maine families have nowhere to turn when food runs short. Reducing access to SNAP will produce nothing short of a statewide emergency. So I'm sure we all agree that we don't want Mainers to go hungry, but we simply cannot meet their needs with food pantries and soup kitchens. We need sound and thoughtful public policy, so we are bringing the results of these surveys to our policymakers in Congress and at the State House and urging them to strengthen and protect SNAP. The really hard work to affect public policy is just beginning, and we invite you to join us. Stand with us to end hunger. To close, I'd like to read part of a poem by Pablo Neruda that we cite on our Preble Street Food Values card. Hunger feels like pinchers, like the bite of crabs. It burns, burns, and has no fire. Hunger is a cold fire. Let us sit down soon to eat with all those who haven't eaten. Let us spread great tablecloths from which we can all eat. For now, I ask no more than the justice of eating.
Thank you, Michael, for the invitation to speak for a few moments this evening, and welcome Mark as well back to Maine, and always good to hear. I was still listening to you. I forgot to come up, and so sorry. It took me a while to get up here. I'm also going to be the first to admit I am a little unprepared. I'm coming off of a four-hour board meeting. I'm a little tired, but my board chair is here, so I'm really happy about that. And you are the only thing that's standing between me and a vacation to Florida, so my brain is like, but I am happy to talk with you a little bit about the work of Good Shepherd Food Bank. Michael shared with you what we do as a food bank, providing the food for over 400 ending hunger partners around the state who are really the boots on the ground of the people, connecting so many low-income Mainers with the essential food they need. And what I wanted to highlight tonight is just how much our work has changed. We historically have always been called the Emergency Food Network. We were food pantries and food banks all around the country emerged in the early 1980s when cuts to a lot of the federal safety net programs started happening and hunger started emerging as a significant problem in the country. And so amazing community members said, well, there's some discarded food here being wasted. I'm going to give it to my neighbors in need while somebody else figures out why my neighbors are hungry. And it's 35 years later, and we are now, as you heard, feeding nearly 15% of our state's population. And so the need is certainly staggering, and it is not what any of our food pantries ever were prepared or ever thought they would have to be doing. The other thing that has really changed is the convergence of hunger and poor health, and recognizing that for so many people who are struggling with hunger, they're also struggling with issues like obesity and chronic illnesses such as diabetes and hypertension. And the reason for that is really quite simple, and it's the result of a broken food system, of where sometimes the most affordable food is often the least healthy. And for people who are sometimes living off of a food stamp budget of $124 a month, and a gallon of milk is $4 and a liter of soda is 79 cents, it doesn't take much math to figure out what's going to be the only choice they can afford. And so we've really started to shift our work in recognizing our work is not about connecting people to calories, it's about connecting people to healthy food. We also realized that we can't just sit back anymore and say, well, we're going to feed people today while other people work on the systemic issues of why our food pantry lines keep getting longer. We have become the experts in this issue because we are the most connected to it, and we can connect the voices of the people we serve to the people who need to hear from them. And it's just this very humbling recognition that we have been doing this work for 35 years and the problem is worse than ever. So if we're not part, we need to be part of the long-term solution to ending hunger. So we are very much focused on getting nutritious food to people in need, and also though using our work to connect the people we serve with other resources that are there to help people stabilize their lives and find a pathway out of poverty. We recognize that our food pantries are prioritized. People living in poverty prioritize food access because they have to, but they have so much going on, other just constant crises, that it's harder for them to prioritize other community resources that can really help them with some of these more systemic issues. So by doing things such as putting food pantries in schools and healthcare centers and other community resource centers, we can make it a lot easier for people to access these programs and start putting together the building blocks to get to that road of stabilization. The other piece that we realized the food bank can play a role in is in strengthening our local food system. We are the result of a broken food system, so we are interested in figuring out, well, how can we help strengthen it? And so we have a program called Mainers Feeding Mainers, where we decided to use our purchasing dollars to support local food. And so we work with our farm partners. We now have 66 farm partners across the state that we enter into pre-season contracts with, giving them a guaranteed revenue that they can plan around while also getting really healthy local food to the people we serve. An amazing benefit from this program that I admit we were not planning on is the role that this program plays in helping restore dignity. Even among our best partners, it is so difficult for somebody to have to go and admit that they need help and seek out that help. And oftentimes the people we serve are constantly needing to seek out help, and they're constantly getting the remnants of everybody else. They're getting donated clothes, they're getting donated cell phones, everything's donated, everything is secondhand. And it takes a lot to go to a food pantry, but to stand in line and get a box of food and it's filled with wilted produce or items that are about to be expired, I feel that that almost affirms that they indeed are second-class citizens, and that is very disheartening. And what we've seen with Mainers Feeding Mainers is we are able to get fresh produce, sometimes harvested within hours or days of right before they're given the food, and we see what it does to restore that dignity, to send that message that you deserve fresh, healthy, quality food. And to me, it's almost more provides more sustenance than the food itself. So I'm really excited about that program. The other thing that I just cannot stress enough is, while I am incredibly proud of the work that the food bank does, and we are committed to making sure every person in Maine has access to healthy food when and where they need it, and we are committed to working with partners to go after some of these root causes of hunger, we are not the solution to hunger. Nobody should have to stand in line and be given a box of food because they can't afford to go to a grocery store. What we need is a strong, strongly supported federal programs like SNAP, like WIC, that allow a person the dignity to go grocery shopping when they have time and pick out the foods that their family wants and be able to pay for it. And that is the solution. So what I look around is I see that you are the solution, helping us figure out how we strengthen our food system and how we advocate for programs to be there for people who are just stuck between, who are just stuck in some of these traps of poverty. The other thing I noticed, which I thought was, as I was scribbling down my notes of what I was going to say today, and reading and saying, what else can I add? And I realized I was writing on the printout of a letter I received from a food pantry director and said, oh, how convenient, because this letter was amazing. In fact, I have it because I shared it with our board today for them to hear the impact of this work. And this is from the Northport Food Pantry in Waldo County. And she wrote this. She said, I wanted to paint a picture of the recipients of the food at our food pantry and wanted you to know that the majority of our clients are the elderly of Waldo County. To many of them taking care of grandchildren. They never imagined that they would not be able to support themselves anymore by fishing or farming, or that their meager pensions would be lost when a factory went bankrupt or just simply moved away. And they never imagined that an illness would take away all the resources that they had meticulously saved for retirement. They also, she mentions, a lot of the families are households with young children. And she said, when young parents come to us, they looked shell-shocked and overwhelmed. Mom is always uncertain how to ask for help. Dad is self-conscious. They usually apologize. They shouldn't. They started out on a pathway with optimism about their family, and they never planned to be standing in line at the food pantry. They never thought that they would be part of the working poor of Waldo County. He did not realize that, sharing a story, did not realize that his wife on active duty with the military would not earn enough money to support feeding the family at home, or that the health insurance would not cover the entire family. I'm just skipping, so you don't want to read the whole thing, even though it's really good. We hear stories that she had given up a job because she couldn't afford daycare, or the vehicle that they needed to get to a job broke down. or the job would be lost because a parent needed to stay at home too often with kids with colds, and obviously a lot of school vacations. If we have any hope of breaking this cycle, we must be sure that these families get the food they need, that their children go to school with breakfast in their stomachs, lunches in their backpacks, and the prospect of dinner together in the evening. No one plans to show up at the door of a food pantry. They each have their own story that is personal and unique, and the one thing that unites them all is that they are hungry. They all deserve a helping hand, and we want to be there to lend that hand. And I'm very excited to hear now. Actually, I think Ms. Michael coming back to introduce Mark. What? Jim. Okay, so Jim's going to take it from here. Thank you.
Well, thank you, Kristen. Thank you, Donna, for those introductory remarks. Thank you all for caring enough about food security in our communities to be here and to hear Mark tonight. My name is Jim Hanna. I direct the Cumberland County Food Security Council. That council is a collaboration of partners that include Preble Street, Good Shepherd Food Bank, many other partners, too many to name. I don't want to favor any by naming them, but we're a very diverse group of people, people in government, people in business, individuals who care about this issue come and provide leadership in the community around addressing the problem of food insecurity. We work together because we recognize that none of us alone can solve this problem of hunger. And we recognize and we agree that people are not hungry due to a lack of food or because they made a personal mistake, but people are food insecure due to our collective failures in democracy and justice. So we advocate based around that value filter. I'm honored to have the opportunity to introduce my friend and colleague, Mark Winne. I met Mark in the mid-90s when he was directing the Hartford Food System. His group was among the first in the nation to integrate systems thinking into food-based problem solving and community organizing. Maine can take some credit for Mark's influence as well because he's a graduate of Bates College and began his food work in Lewiston. He was ahead of his time, working on the current food movement as it was just beginning to move. His first book, Closing the Food Gap, does a great job of telling the story of the roots of this movement, illustrating moments of clarity, like the bipartisan U.S. Senate report in 1974 that said, the fundamental issue facing the hungry is not the mechanics of the food assistance program, as it is in the fact of persistent poverty and the continued tolerance in this country of a starkly inequitable distribution of income. You can read more in his book, which is available tonight. You know, he also points to the early 80s when a new administration came in and removed all the investments we'd been making into these food programs. We nearly solved the problem of food insecurity. And the Reagan administration came in the first 12 months, deconstructed much of the progress we'd made. We're still feeling that impact today. Mark was also a founder of the National Community Food Security Coalition. It convened diverse food practitioners from around the country in an annual conference. This gathering of food activists initiated and nurtured local initiatives like urban agriculture, food hubs, farm to school, food policy councils. All these things were born in this collaboration that Mark was at the beginning of and was directly instrumental in founding. He actually visited Portland City Hall in 1997 to advise us on the formation of the first Food Policy Council. I sit on the most recent iteration of that. There was some break in between, but Mark's been advising communities for longer than 20 years around how to organize and do food work. He currently serves as a senior advisor to the Food Policy Networks Project at the Johns Hopkins University Center for a Livable Future. He lives in Santa Fe, New Mexico, where he works locally participating in the Santa Fe Food Policy Council. His current book, which will be released at any moment, I think it's coming out this month, is titled Stand Together or Starve Alone, Unity and Chaos in the U.S. Food Movement. It speaks to the challenges and power of collaboration in our work. And since you're interested enough to be here, I want to invite you all and welcome you to another convening tomorrow at 12:30 to 2:30. We're going to be in the Wish Campers Center. A group of us will be meeting in a more intimate setting with Mark to talk about collaboration and reflect a little bit on what he's going to be presenting in his book and how we're working locally. So all of you are welcome to join us. That's, again, 12:30 to 2:30 tomorrow at the Wish Campers Center, room 133. And it's going to be a session on effective collaboration and meaningful change in the food system. At this time, let's have a generous welcome for Mark Winne.
Jim is still too tall. Hello, everybody. It is great to be here. Thank you so much. What a great turnout. I really appreciate that. Jim, thanks for that generous introduction. You know, we have been working together a long time, and I think we've done some good along the way. And thank you. It was great to hear from Donna and Christine. It's, you know, it's really, you bring in some guy like me from New Mexico who really doesn't know very much about Maine, but so it's good to hear from real local experts who can tell you what's going on. So I think that's very helpful in framing the discussion, and I do hope we have time for some good discussion. I mean, I can tell right away that we might have some disagreements, and that's good. I think that's healthy. I am going to say, I think right from the start that, I am going to be talking about what I believe are the underlying structural causes of hunger. And I am going to be talking about the need for us to be working together more effectively than we have been in the past. My first book, Closing the Food Gap, that's out on the table, we're selling it for $10. What a great deal that is. I'm happy to sign it, and I found over the years when I sign a book, it actually adds 10 cents in value to it right away. So, take advantage of that. And then my next book, Stand Together or Starve Alone, is really very much about the need to collaborate, that the food movement in all of its dimensions that's been evolving since probably even the 1960s tends to fragment itself, tends to go off in too many different directions. And I think, as already we've heard from just the introduction from Donna and Christine, that we do need to find ways to work together more effectively. So that's going to really be the emphasis of my talk. I also want to thank, of course, Michael Hillard and Lisa Marie Lindenschmidt for bringing me here and to participate in this sort of evolution and launching, I don't know, of your food studies program. I know you've been launched, but now you're accelerating, and that's a great thing. I know food study programs have been proliferating across campuses all across the United States. It's just a wonderful thing. When I was in college in Maine, we had no idea what a food study program was, and no one ever thought of it. I might have been the first person to go there and say, I want to get extra credit. I think I called it extra credit at the time. I think it's probably, I'm sure there's a better sounding term now, but I said, I've been doing some work in Lewiston, and I had been, actually had started a food co-op. I was involved in starting a breakfast program for kids in sort of the downtown neighborhoods. And I said, I wanted to see if I can't develop this as an independent study. I remember the professors looking at me like I was completely crazy. You just don't do that here. You're supposed to learn by being in the classroom, and that was it, and reading books, not being in the community. So I had to be a bit disruptive in my early years in college. So I'm so happy that there are such things as food study programs everywhere, almost everywhere across the country. As you might imagine, somebody, like me who comes and speaks to a college or university will start off, telling long, boring stories about their own college days. And I see no reason to break with that tradition. So my long, boring story, maybe it won't be too long, is that when I was at Bates, I had my very first experience of hunger, but it was a vicarious experience completely. I grew up in a very privileged environment. I did not ever have any idea what hunger was. So in the early age of 18, and as a freshman, who certainly knew a lot more then than he knows now, I became aware of famine in Africa through some very horrifying glossy photographs in Newsweek magazine. And this was in the late 60s, and it was starving children who were the victim of a famine that was largely induced by a civil war and a lot of political strife. And I sort of took it upon my, I was shocked. This was like my first time being like confronted with that kind of scene. And I think I actually remember at that time that it might have been one of the first times as a young adult that I cried as I was witnessing that. And it sort of set the stage, you might say, for a long, lifelong existential crisis. Because there is a fact of hunger in the world. We've already heard that. There's a fact of hunger in Maine. And as I would later discover, there was in fact a fact of hunger in the United States. These were the facts for which I couldn't actually say I had any personal responsibility, but I did feel compelled to act. I felt compelled to respond, I think, which, as many of you feel compelled to act and to respond. Like Jean-Paul Sartre once said, we may not be able to control the things that happen to us, but we can exercise control over how we act toward them. So my reaction to those faces, those young children staring back at me from the pages of Newsweek, their faces were swarmed with flies, was characteristic, I think, of any enthusiastic and privileged young person, which was to do something, do anything, but do it now. And what I did is I went out and kind of shook down my fellow students and faculty for money. I started my first fundraising campaign in my life. And I think since then I've probably been engaged in fundraising almost every day of my life since then. But this is my very first fundraising project. And I raised all of $600, which I promptly gave to an international relief agency. And as I made the campus rounds collecting money, I gained a few admirers, made a few enemies, and I think I might have got a couple of dates with women who otherwise would not have paid attention to me at all. But regardless of that, I was very enthusiastic in my approach to ending hunger, and I was just as enthusiastic as I was horrified. But I also realized that over time, it's not so much the response or the immediate response that counts. It's your analysis and it's your reflection. And it's how you kind of come out of that emotional experience with a clear plan of how to act. And also being aware that over time you will have to adjust your actions to fit the circumstances to find out what works and what doesn't. As strongly as we may be called to act in the face of the terrors that regularly visit the earth, the question of how best to act should ultimately guide us, though the question of what to do will no doubt torment us for the better part of our lives. 49 years have passed since that time, since this earnest young college freshman who certainly was thought he had all the answers, first set out on his journey to change the world, a world that was filled with hunger, food insecurity, poor food access, diet-related health problems like obesity and diabetes, and more recently, the recognition that our appetite for nearly anything we can lay our hands on is turning our earth into a climactic cauldron that will render some not too distant generation into a well-cooked stew if we don't act. But how do we act? And that's where I'll begin to kind of explore this discussion more thoroughly. Finding the causes and then devising appropriate solutions is certainly a tricky business, as I discovered over a lifetime of doing community food work. And I would find out that challenging the orthodoxies of any group at any time is always a risky business. Like membership in a religion, those who work for anti-hunger institutions and organizations sometimes feel that their principles and their work is inviolable. I discovered that the hard way during the course of promoting my first book, Closing the Food Gap, which was released in 2008. At that time, I had been asked by an editor of the Washington Post opinion section to write an essay that was based on the book, based on the assumptions that I made in the book. I did that in November of 2007. In the essay that ran on the section's front page, above the fold with an entire half page of Andy Warhol soup cans to symbolize food banks, I said that while I had been the founder of a food bank in Hartford, Connecticut, the number of food banks growing was not a legacy that anyone should be necessarily proud of. With the number of food banks that are now well over 200 compared to zero food banks in the late 1970s, and the number of food pantries well beyond 60,000 in other emergency food sites, food insecurity was as prevalent as ever. Poverty had increased. Hunger had been eclipsed by even more insidious and pervasive threats such as obesity and diabetes. I went on to say that the success of food banking, which is a private charity approach to a massive social and economic problem, had somewhat distracted our attention from the need for a more systemic response. While they had been doing enormously important work and providing a relief to a crisis that they had to respond to, the communities had to respond to, we were not as a nation nor as communities doing an effective job in bringing a resolution to the problem. Well, I acknowledged two mistakes. The first was that the article ran on the Sunday before Thanksgiving. And second, I included my email address. The deluge of feedback was so intense, there were 86,000 hits on the website, on the Washington Post website on that article within 2 days, which the editor told me was the most they'd ever had on any topic up until that point. And I had about 500 emails sitting in my inbox within 24 hours. It was so intense that I actually got a headache that lasted for 2 weeks, and I had to go in and get an MRI because the headache was so bad, and they discovered there was nothing wrong. It was just the stress, and it cost me $500 of a copay, which was the same amount that the Washington Post had paid me for the article. So I guess I broke even. I don't know, but anyway, that was just a sidelight of what happens sometimes. again, you know, this was pushing against something at the time that I felt was we were not yet getting this right. You know, we were still, you know, I had been very much engaged in doing this work in communities for a long time. I'd been running the Hartford food system. I'd been setting up food banks. I had been doing public policy work very aggressively trying to address food insecurity and health-related problems in my community. But I didn't yet see that, you know, we were making enough of a difference. So I wanted to explore this topic a little bit more with you and just begin to look at it and see if we can't begin to get a little bit closer to some solution. So I'm going to take a look at a few slides with you, and I think I got my little hoosie here, okay, just to kind of, you know, again, you know, the fact of hunger is a reality. The fact that we respond in a way that we can because we have an emotional response to this, and perhaps maybe the most emotional response to any of our social and economic problems in this country, is something that we have to then inform with analysis. So it's always interesting to take a step back and look at history. I think we have to. We better. I always find some irony in a few of these facts, which is that the school lunch program, which is an enormously important program in the lives of our children in this country, some children are getting almost 50% of their daily calories from school meal programs today. President Truman created the program right after World War II in response to the fact that military recruits were undernourished and they were rejected for military service because they're undernourished. Today, the leading cause of rejection of military recruits and volunteers, primarily, is obesity. So we've kind of gone in another direction. But Truman argued that our national security was at stake, and that's why we decided to have a school meal program, not because we thought school meal programs were a good idea or feeding children was a good idea. In a similar vein, John F. Kennedy created the food stamp program, the modern-day food stamp program, what we know of it as today as SNAP, right after, I believe it was either his first or second executive action, when he took office in 1961. And he created it primarily because he had lost a lot of the Farm Belt states. And knowing that they were important votes for him in the future, he decided, well, I'm going to establish this food stamp program partly because it will increase farm prices. It will help farmers because the demand will increase. So he did that. You know, it's always a bit of that pragmatic political part that's a part of the evolution of our food programs. And this one I discovered a while ago, I find it pretty interesting, was that we're all pretty familiar with Upton Sinclair in the jungle, where he, you know, one of the very first muckraking pieces to take on the food system. You might say he was the Michael Pollan of his day. But he set out on his journey to write that book based on the fact that he wanted to expose the terrible working conditions that faced people in slaughter plants, livestock slaughter plants during the day. And of course, in the course of doing that, he also exposed the terrible safety issues and health issues associated with the meat that was coming out of those places. But as he says, I aimed at the public's heart, and by accident, I hit it in the stomach. I wanted people to know, he said, that workers were suffering. It wasn't, but in fact, what happened as a result of his work is that we ended up with more food safety regulations, which of course is a good thing, but we missed the point that this was about trying to help workers. Today, you know, and these numbers are always changing, but we have a high food insecurity rate of over 12%. That's compared to 10% in 1999. And we have over 42 million people participating in the SNAP program, compared to 25 million in 2004. Now, keep in mind that we had intervening period, we had the Great Recession. That's when SNAP participation rose to around 49 million. However, it's interesting that it really hasn't dropped a tremendous amount since the end of the Great Recession. And we expect that even today, in times of very low unemployment and relative prosperity, a tremendous number of Americans are still participating in the SNAP program and need the SNAP program. World population is 10 billion, which I put in there to remind us that there is indeed a hungry world out there, and it's just going to get hungrier, and that there are many, many agronomists who don't believe we have the capacity to serve or to feed 10 billion people when they appear on the planet. And poverty. It's poverty I want to talk about, and poverty, which I think is the story. And I'm going to do the best I can with it, but you know, we have a very high poverty rate in this country. Again, this has gone down a couple of percentage points since the end of the Great Recession, but it is still abnormally high for a developed nation such as the U.S. Family income is indeed the best predictor of food insecurity and obesity. And I add obesity because there was an interesting study done by the University of Michigan that found an association between poverty, food deserts, and fewer physical activity options. You just think about it. I'm living in a poor neighborhood. I'm living where it's perhaps densely built. I'm living in a place maybe that's in a rural part of the state. I don't have a lot of physical activity options. You know, when I was working in Hartford, people did not want to send their children out to play. They kept them at home. They were afraid that if they went outside, something would happen to them. And indeed, crime was very high. Drug use was very high. and there were very few places to play. Playgrounds were few, small, and often broken down. So lack of physical activity, high rates of poverty, and resulting diet-related health problems from obesity and diabetes came about. We have one of the highest rates of childhood poverty in the industrialized world. And the number, this last number always sort of strikes me. It really kind of begins to get at, I think, the extent of the problem here. We're not just talking about a core, small, relatively small minority of Americans who are affected by this. 99 million Americans are living at 185% of the poverty level, which is almost a third of Americans. And that level of poverty qualifies them for a number of food assistance programs. So, you know, we're not just talking about a few people. We're talking about a lot of people. Obesity is something that continues to perplex a lot of us, and particularly in the public health world. 37% of adults are obese compared to 23% in 1994, and I still wonder at times what the causes of that are, why that number has gone up so dramatically. But certainly the rates are higher among African American, Hispanic, and Native Americans. There was one piece of research that was done in New Mexico, in my home state, by our state health department, comparing Native Americans, Hispanics, with a very large Hispanic population, a very large Native American population, and white or Anglo students. And these are in third grade. They do BMI tests. I have some, but thanks. And it was disturbing to see that the rates of obesity among Native American third graders was 30%. For Hispanics, it was about 23%. And for white/Anglo, it was 13%. To me, that really points out the racial disparities that we have around food insecurity and health. And we also see that the SNAP recipients are, and the food insecure in general, are eating half of the levels of fruit and vegetables that the so-called food secure are eating. So along again with poverty, along with food insecurity, people are eating less healthy food. And food deserts, which is a concept we've been, you know, working with for a long time, and are, you know, still fairly significant, though I think there's been some progress made in reducing the number of food deserts through some very active and engaging food programs out there, establishing new sites, making it easier for people to get to sources of healthy food. Nevertheless, is affecting a significant number of people. Now, food banking, I know I sometimes sound a little too negative, even though I feel that food banks are a very important part of our system. But this quote from Sharon Thornberry, who is one of the sort of leading activists in the food banking world and from Oregon, says that food banking is not what anyone would have chosen if we sat down to rationally end hunger. That always strikes me. I thought that if we had this to do over again, would we do it the same way that we did do it? I don't know. I don't think we would. I mean, knowing what we know now, would there have been a different way of approaching it? And I'm not sure I can tell you what that different way would be. But I always think that it's important to try to look back and say, why are we doing it this way now? Is this the best way? And could we be doing it differently? And maybe understanding again what some of the causes and effect are. As I said earlier, there's the social I said it in a class that I was talking to earlier today. I said there's been a change in the social contract. We've shifted from the public sector to the private sector, from justice to charity. To me, this has been this big shift that took place from the 60s and the 70s, as we were pointing out early, when we almost got to the point where we did end hunger in the United States. And then there was this incredible shift in the way that we wanted to, that what we thought was the public responsibility. a public sector responsibility to address these kind of these significant social and economic problems we had in this country. And we moved away from it. And then we responded as a community. We came together and said, we got to address this problem. If the federal government and other governments aren't going to step up, then we have to as individuals and as organizations, as faith communities and so forth. But I call this the IKEA effect. We had to build it ourselves, right? We had to put it together ourselves from scratch. And that's kind of where we went. And I've been a little perplexed also by the evolution of food banks at colleges and universities. I discovered just 3 years ago when I was speaking at a university the first time that there were such a thing as college food banks. And at the time, I checked, they found they had this food bank association that had been established. And at the time, there were about 240 members. That was in actually just 2 years ago. And today is like 500. I said, wow, I mean, this has been the response that students, I hadn't realized that now students were faced with, you know, enormous debt from loans, student loans. They were probably also working jobs while they were going to school. They were trying to get by and not being able to make ends meet. And now they had to go to food banks. I said, boy, this is another sort of evolution in our, in these, and maybe it's, again, it's the IKEA effect, but I think it's some way that we keep thinking about problems. I think it was mentioned earlier how food pantries have become a regular source of food, not just an emergency, but a regular part. It's like going, it's a little bit like, you know, this is where I go to get my food now. When did this shift take place? Why did it take place? Why did we kind of keep moving down this path of trying to, of shifting the social contract away from the public sector into the lap of the private sector, the charitable sector? I think one of the best statements on all of this came out of from a gentleman named Olivier DeShooter, who is or was the special rapporteur for the United Nations on food and food security. And he talks about how justice, or rather charity, has displaced justice. He says that food banks should not be seen as a normal part of the national safety net. They are charity-based, not rights-based. And they should not be seen as a substitute for the robust social safety net into which each individual has a right. Everyone has a right to food. Everyone has a right to that safety net. DeShooter goes on to say that food banks play a very important role in identifying quickly and accurately how the safety net is broken. I'm sure as people are coming into food pantries and the food banks, you're hearing the stories that we heard today. And we need to report those stories, as I'm sure people are reporting them. So it's the fact of testimony that needs to be brought to the attention, you know, that we need to testify and we need to act on that aggressively. As such, food banks have a special obligation to report, as any good witness must, what they are seeing. Governments should not be allowed to escape the obligations because private charities make up for their failures. Each of us as citizens have to hold our governments accountable. And I know you are doing that in the state of Maine. I know you have some real serious challenges here. But people do have to hold them accountable. At the same time, we have to hold our federal government accountable. There's another facet to the challenges we face. You know, it's not just the way that we've been doing business, it's what we have not been doing as well. And one of the things that, and this is what I take up in my latest book, is the lack of unity, called the lack of collaboration. The lack, maybe you could even say, it's a lack of cooperation among the many different sectors of the food movement. Keep in mind, I've been around so long that I see the different elements of the food system, the different food sectors that have emerged. You know, people gravitate toward anti-hunger work. Other people have gravitated toward the local food movement, wanting to make sure that we have lots of, you know, locally produced food. Other people maybe gravitate towards sustainability. Some people more recently are gravitating toward trying to reduce food waste. We tend to get sort of fixated on taking our certain positions, and it's important that we learn how to be effective within some narrow range of, you know, narrow set of skills that we need in order to do our work. But then we start to lose sight of the bigger picture. We don't work easily and naturally with others. And this is something that I think has a problem that has plagued the food movement, and it's gotten worse over time because the food movement keeps getting bigger and more diversified. We have to figure out a way to bring it back together. Maybe people are familiar with the term collective impact. It's a term that's been bandied about maybe a bit too much, to the point where it's perhaps been diluted in terms of its meaning. But imagine, and I think perhaps this is what is going on with, you know, with Jim's work and the Cumberland Food Policy Council, is that people come together, they begin to establish common goals, they begin to establish common measurements. They say that toward those goals, we're not all going to do the same thing. We're going to do what we do and know, but we're also going to be, we agree that these are the responsibilities that we share, the actions, the activities that we each as organizations undertake. But they're all designed to reach a common goal. And we're going to agree to talk to each other a lot, frequently, not maybe once a quarter, not have sort of a 30-minute conference call, but we're really going to get together and talk to each other a lot. You know, these are the elements, and that, as well as having some coordinating mechanism, we sometimes call it a backbone organization, some coordinating hub that will help us work together. We don't use this method often enough. At the national level, we don't have anything that looks like a joined-up food policy, which means that we're going to be looking at food security, health, sustainability, and economic development all at the same time. You know, we spend, for instance, over $100 billion a year on federal food programs, and very little of that money has an impact on our local economies nor our nutritional health. These are the things that we're not connecting these big food programs with. If SNAP was targeted more toward healthy eating, if we designed it in such a way that we could increase its impact on economic development, you know, we might be seeing more of a bigger shift and a more positive shift in our food problems or food programs. I've been concerned over the years that some of our anti-hunger organizations are a little too close to what I perceive as part of the problem. The Food Research Action Center, which is our biggest anti-hunger program, has not been in favor of innovations in the SNAP program, in particular, potentially ending the eligibility of sugary soft drinks to be purchased with SNAP benefits. Their sponsors for their annual conferences typically include the following food corporations, which I do think is part of the problem. Our School Food Association has resisted changes in school food meal standards. This is based on some research that a colleague of mine, Andy Fisher, has done. You might want to check out his book, which is called Big Hunger. And he actually took a look at the makeup of the board of directors of the nation's he looked at over 150 food banks, which is about three-quarters of the nation's food banks. And the board of directors, 22% of them come from Fortune 1000 companies. So you begin to say, is the lack of aggressive action on the part of food banks and the anti-hunger world in part at least being influenced by corporations which themselves have an interest in preserving the status quo? Now, there have been shifts, there have been changes in this over the years, but nevertheless, I think it's something we have to take a look at. What we have found in the course of trying to work with anti-hunger organizations is there hasn't been a really clear and decisive interest in terms of actually caring where the food comes from. If the local food movement, for instance, was more closely aligned with the anti-hunger movement, we would begin to see some, perhaps see some more substantial changes. You know, we have seen this incredible growth in what we might call community food security. The local response, the changes in our food system, the development of an alternative food system. Call it what you will. I mean, I think many of us probably participate in farmers markets. There were only 340 in 1970. Today, there's over 8,500. CSAs have become a big deal. Now, farm-to-school programs, about 43% of all public schools in the U.S. now have a farm-to-school program. There was one in 1996. Food hubs is well over, it's probably about 500. I should have updated this slide, but there are about 500, at least 500 food hubs. There's been a substantial number of projects led by the Healthy Food Financing Initiative to bring new projects, new stores, new outlets to low-income food deserts. And we've seen a tremendous growth in food policy councils, 250 today. We do surveys at Johns Hopkins quite a bit with food policy councils and found that there were about 100 in 2010. Today there's over 250. And we've seen some new policies developed at the federal level that make the connections that I'm talking about. WIC and senior farmers market programs. We have more SNAP benefits being accepted at farmers markets. The FINNE program, which is the Food Insecurity Nutrition Initiative, I never quite get that right, has come along, and we're making these connections again between local food, farmers markets, CSAs, and low-income people. Local and state food policies have been growing over the years, and over 2,000 cities now have some kind of food policy. Food waste has become an important area of interest. 36 states have enacted 91 bills just in a three-year period. So all of these tend to suggest that there is positive direction, but it's still on the small side. It still isn't joined up and hooked up with some of the bigger initiatives in the world, in the country. So we need to be paying more attention. We're starting to see soda taxes imposed, and with the idea of trying to reduce the consumption of sugary soft drinks. But we do keep falling short. And part of the reason that I think we are falling short is because we are not addressing poverty, income, and wealth inequality. The food movement doesn't collaborate, I've already said that. And I also am concerned that funders don't support long-term collaborative-based solutions. Funders too often are looking for a quick fix. They don't want to do that 5-year, 10-year kind of work. Oops. If we look at the facts around income inequality, I think they're rather disturbing. That the top 1% took 19% of all income in the U.S., and the top 10% took almost half. 74% of U.S. private wealth is held by the top 10%. Now, keep in mind, this is an important distinction when you're talking about income, when talking about inequality, is that, you know, we're not just talking about your paycheck, about how much money is coming in to you. We're also talking about how much wealth you have in terms of your value of homes, in terms of your investments, in terms of what's in the bank. And that's where the disparities grow even greater. People have money sitting in investments that are sitting there and earning 5, 6, 7, sometimes 10% a year. They're not doing any work. They're just accumulating more and more money. When they say the rich get richer, they're right. It's a simple fact of finance and mathematics. You just keep adding back into what you already have. If you don't have any investments, if you don't own a home, if you really don't have any money in the bank, you're living more or less paycheck to paycheck, you don't have that. You don't have the advantage of your wealth accumulating any kind of return over time. Piketty said that America is the most unequal nation on earth. And I was really, when I read that, it really kind of hit me. He's right. That's what indeed what our problem is. There was a study done by the U.S. Department of Agriculture, probably a study that won't be done for the next 4 years, but fortunately it was done and completed before the last election, that found that income inequality increased, that childhood poverty in rural areas increased largely due to income inequality, that they found a strong relationship between the two. So we have to keep this in mind. And looking at the minimum wage, which hasn't budged in a long time in the U.S., some research has suggested that 70% of U.S. poverty is attributed to declining value of the minimum wage. Keep in mind that in 1969, for instance, the minimum wage was $2.20. I was working that summer and for a landscaper. I was digging ditches and planting trees and shrubs. And with a minimum wage of $2.20 an hour, that's what I was getting paid. However, that $2.20 bought $10.95 worth of goods back then. So I felt really rich that I was making that much money that summer. I could actually do something with it. But today, that value has eroded down to almost $7.25. Basically, it will only get you that much. Look at the minimum wage in other developed countries, and we compare very poorly. You know, if our minimum wage was only increased to $10.10, we could see a reduction in poverty, number of people in poverty, and the reduction in the cost of the SNAP program. And if the minimum wage grew at the same rate as the incomes of the top 1%, it would be $22 an hour. So you can see we've lagged so far behind. You know, this is a serious justice issue, and it's one that has to be addressed by all of us. I'm going to, I know there's been some discussion. I was in the class today. I know there are some people looking at wages and conditions in the food industry, in the restaurant industry, and fast food, and also in Walmart. We can see how much of the shift has taken place in who pays for what. People, you know, the McDonald's depends and other fast food places depend on the public sector to cover the costs that are not being covered by wages. People don't make enough money to put food on their table, to pay for health care, to pay for all the other expenses, to pay for the rent. So the government steps in. The same with Walmart. Yes, Walmart donated $2 billion to food banks a couple of years ago, but their employees received $6 billion in public assistance that year due to the fact that they're generally underpaid. I don't know if people know of the Food Chain Workers Alliance. It's probably one of the best and most effective food worker organizations in the country. But I think this statement is important. She's basically asking the anti-hunger groups to play a larger role with economic justice. If we could bring them together, they would, and have bring them into contact, then we might begin to see some more progress. In other words, we have to join the concerns of low-income workers, organized groups like the Food Chain Workers Alliance, together with anti-hunger organizations, including food banks. The idea again of how we make a difference, and this is perhaps the most concrete illustration I can give you this evening, which is something that took place in East Harlem, New York. And around the year 2000, East Harlem had probably the worst poverty statistics, some of the worst health statistics, the highest rates of food insecurity, certainly in New York City, but also in the country. There was a tremendous increase during a very strong effort made at the time to provide better services and to try to make investments in economic development in East Harlem. As a result, there was a significant increase in the number of supermarkets, farmers markets, green carts. There were a lot of programs, a lot of projects that went on, and a significant commitment by the public sector. However, what they found is that after, what happened is the policy, New York City Food Policy Center went back in 2011 and they did some research and they found that during that time, there had not been a significant decrease in diet-related illnesses. There had not been a significant decrease in poverty, nor had there been a significant decrease in food insecurity. And even in spite of this major investment in improving food access, and so the reason, and what they looked at, they said they decided to come, they made these recommendations, which was to create more community-based enterprises. There had been too much reliance on large, supermarkets and bringing in new box stores, in fact, into East Harlem. They felt that they needed to also reduce the promotion and the availability of unhealthy food. They had to develop creative ways to use SNAP to encourage the purchase of healthy food. They had to create a food hub that would allow for food to be purchased and distributed more easily. They also recommended the creation of a food policy council and a more centralized approach. In other words, they basically recommended a collective impact approach. They came back and said, we're not working together. We're not getting the results we're looking for. And even though we have a lot of new projects going on, we're not getting the results because we're not working together. One other sort of related example of this is the need for what I call multiple interventions. If you're trying to change somebody's eating behavior or you're trying to make conditions better in one place, we've had this tendency to develop like one project at a time, one new idea. We're going to bring a new supermarket into this low-income area, and that's what we need. That's all we need to do. Or we need to perhaps introduce a soda tax, and that will reduce the consumption of sugary soft drinks, and that will solve our problems. That doesn't work. You can't do just one thing. You have to do several things, and they have to be united in a common approach. A good illustration of this is a project that Johns Hopkins did in Baltimore, where they looked at two independent supermarkets, very similar in terms of size and their markets. And they stocked both of them. These were in lower income areas. They were heavily stocked with fruits and vegetables. One of them had numerous interventions, such as lots of in-store displays, in-store education programs, people actually talking to the shoppers, lots of labeling. In those stores, they saw a 28% increase in the purchase of healthy food. But in the other store, they didn't do any of that. They didn't do any of those additional interventions. They simply put more food on the shelves. They only had a 6% increase. So it illustrates how we need to bring multiple players and multiple approaches into the equation. So I'm just going to wind up with a few recommendations that funders have to become more engaged in actually developing grassroots leadership. I mean, I was happy to hear that, you know, that the people who need these services and who are clients of food banks are beginning to become the advocates and speaking up on their own behalf. Food assistance programs need to provide more leeway for innovation. Labor and community food security and anti-hunger groups have to form more effective alliances. We need to spend more time collectively on providing healthy food for everybody. And my own recommendation is that we impose a 1% tax on private capital for the highest 10% of wealth holders. Believe it or not, that alone would generate $300 billion a year of new income at the national level. We need to have more cross-sector collaboration, more multi-intervention strategies. We need to make use of collective impact. And this last point is we need to avoid shiny objects I don't want to sing, I mean, I will point out food waste is something that I am sometimes a bit perplexed about, because there's been, what we tend to do, and I've seen this take place in many different, over the years with many different new initiatives, is that we think that this is going to be the solution. Food waste is a great idea that will help the planet if we can reduce the amount of food waste, and we do waste a tremendous amount of food in this country. It'll be good for the planet, and much and a lot of that food can be diverted to food insecure people. But we also have to remember that that alone is not the solution. There are actually several major environmental organizations based in Washington which have received millions of dollars from foundations to establish food waste divisions within their organizations, and have hired 6 or 7 or 8 staff people. I find that a little bit disturbing, that that much emphasis might be given to one new area. So yes, it's an important thing to keep in mind as part of our understanding of the food system, but let's not run to it as like the next great solution. I think the last point that I want to make is that it actually comes from a letter, or actually an email, that I received a couple of years ago from a student at Vanderbilt University. And I responded to her in this way, if I can find it. It's not there, just a moment. Here we go. The email came from a junior at Vanderbilt who's named Rebecca. She had just finished reading my book, Closing the Food Gap, and she said she had a couple of questions, and I did my best to answer them. And then she asked me, what should someone like me do to address social injustice? That was an interesting question. Though I wasn't sure exactly who somebody like her was, I assumed that she was someone like me when I was someone like her, because she was asking the same questions I asked when I was her age. So I referred her to a letter that I had actually, a made-up letter that I had written for a talk I had given a 3 or 4 years ago. And it kind of came out of this thing that, out of this experience that I have, is that I speak to a lot of different groups, a lot of food organizations in particular, and often they thank me by putting me on their solicitation list. So I get letters from them asking for money, particularly this time of year as we kind of lead up to the holidays. And many of the fundraising letters that I get are from food banks. And the letters rarely vary in terms of what their message is. And they talk about increasing the amount of food poundage they're distributing, and how they tell personal stories of people who are part of the food bank. And I find it very interesting, but I also wonder why the letters don't seem to ever kind of speak to the larger issues, to some of the more complex and challenging issues. So I made up this letter from a food bank director that I actually think now we have a lot more of than when I did write the letter, but still we could use a lot more. So it's made up. But here's what I said. I said, "Dear Mr. Winne, we have great news for you this year. We at the food bank are happy to report that for the first time in our history, we have donated less food this year than the previous one. Why are we happy about that? Well, it's because of what happened to Sally Jones, a former client of the food bank, a former client. Sally is a single mother of 2 children. She works part-time in a nursing home and now takes regular classes at the community college to become a nurse. She is a former client of ours because our city passed a living wage law that requires employers to pay their workers at least $12.50 an hour. The extra income, coupled with free daycare and health insurance she now receives, enables Sally to put food on the table without our help. While we miss seeing Sally around the food bank, we do see her occasionally at our community garden, where she and her children are growing vegetables. Vegetables that, by the way, she learned to prepare in healthy and delicious ways at our Cooking with Community program. All this progress, including the drop in the pounds of food distributed, was made possible by donors like you, Mr. Winne. Your hefty two-figure contribution, when joined with those of somewhat more munificent donors, enabled the food bank to dedicate an ever greater share of its budget to advocacy training and public policy work. We have also joined forces with other farmers in the region, and we have also working with a food hub, and we are actually helping a food hub, and we are now members of a local food policy council as well. This work persuaded our city council, all this training and public advocacy, to pass the living wage ordinance, and it persuaded the state legislature to fully support health care, as well as an adequate funding for child care and community colleges. We also worked to ensure that Congress fully funded nutrition programs. But you know what the best news is? It wasn't just our paid staff who worked for these changes. It was also our hundreds of volunteers and thousands of donors who wrote letters, made phone calls, and showed up in busloads at public hearings. And you know who else showed up, Mr. Winne? Sally Jones, because we helped her gain enough confidence to tell her story to our lawmakers and to tell them that she only wanted a fair chance for herself and her children. She wanted a helping hand, not a handout. So please help us continue our work of empowering more and more of our clients and neighbors so that we can distribute less food year after year. With appreciation, the executive director. And P.S., Mr. Winne, if there's any chance you could raise your donation to the low three-figure range, we'd be very grateful. So that's my story. I'm sticking to it. And I'm very grateful for the good work you are all doing. I'm very grateful for your interest in being here tonight. And let's keep on doing it, but let's try to do more of it together. Thank you very much.
Okay, we have about 25 minutes for vigorous discussion. And we're actually recording this, so we're looking forward to having this eventually on the USM Food Studies website. And because of that, if you're going to speak, I'm going to do the Oprah thing and bring the microphone to you. So if you don't mind, if you want to speak or ask a question, please raise your hand and I will come to you. Kent, if you wouldn't mind saying your name and introducing yourself.
I'm Lynn Holland. I'm with the University of Maine Cooperative Extension. And I work with Master Gardener volunteers who do gleaning. And our goal in the gleaning program is to get good quality food as opposed to leftovers to those folks that are in need. But my background is actually in the supermarket industry, more years than I'll admit to. And my question in food studies and in all of this, we seem to be looking at a parallel food system as opposed to integrating it with the supermarket systems who are really experts in food procurement, cutting food waste, food distribution. And basically, you know, those are the people who know what they're doing. My background in supermarkets, I don't think I was ever approached by anybody except for whatever we had left over that was going out of code. So, I mean, as we look at being more collaborative, I think that's a direction that really should be looked at.
I think you make a good point. I don't know if, I know that food banks have worked with supermarkets. I know, Jim, do you have any involved in your effort?
A
few.
Partners.
There's some partners there. You're right, they would be the experts on a lot of those things. And I think there's always been some reluctance to approach supermarkets and make them a part of a larger community effort. And I know that in the past when I've approached them and others have approached them, they said, oh yeah, well, we'll send a representative to a meeting, or it's often a, kind of more of a public relations person, not a, you know, management person. So the conversations haven't always been that productive. I'm not sure there's any animosity, but I think we just need to try harder. But I think it's a good point. Thanks for raising it.
say your name first?
Yes.
Hi, I'm Kelly, and I go to school here. I was just wondering how we could support more people like putting the trash in the correct receptacles, because I know here on campus almost every single receptacle has directly beside it, like actually attached to it, a recycling and a returnables. Yet again and again, as I'm walking around school, like I see and I like am literally like shoulder deep in the trash can, like pulling out like returnables and recyclables, because people still throw them in the trash can. So I'm just wondering if like you personally have done any research, or like if you know how, like even on campus, if people could just help make people like actually throw it away like where they're supposed to, or anything like that, because it just seems crazy that like highly educated people, students and faculty alike, are still seemingly incapable of like moving one thing 5 inches to the right or the left.
I'm definitely not an expert on how to get people to better recycle wasted products, but I do one piece of sort of communication research that I always find interesting is that usually the more people know about a subject, the more likely they are to do the right thing, and also making it as easy as possible to do the right thing, whether you're encouraging them to eat healthy food or recycle, packaging. And if you were to actually tell a bit of a story about that recycling, why it matters, what's the energy relationship in that soda can that could be, recovered? What would it do for the planet if, what would the impact be if everybody in this community was recycling? I mean, telling that bigger story sometimes makes people get it a little better, and they sort of understand how their individual action relates to a bigger problem. That would be mine. And I'm sure there's others here who can come up with a lot smarter ideas than I have. I did, the one thing I always remember, this was a visit to Case Western Reserve University in Ohio several years ago, and I was in the food, one of the dining service halls, and they were trying to get students to reduce the waste in the school and in the cafeteria, and they had put up on the wall kind of the amount of food that had been wasted a month before they started this program, and they had this like a chart, you might say, that they were filling in. And then because they were telling people about all these things they can do to reduce waste and what the effect is and why it's valuable, the amount of waste started to go down. But they recorded it on the chart. So in other words, people were getting immediate feedback about what their behavior was doing. And giving people immediate feedback is always a good way to kind of reinforce certain behaviors. So that's about as much as I know about communication theory. Yes, sir.
Good evening, Mark. My name is Mark Swan. I work at Preble Street.
Oh, yeah.
I think we're going to see you Friday.
Yeah.
I really appreciate your comments, but in the spirit of dialogue, I did want to kind of gently push back a little bit,
mm-hmm.
And wondering if you feel there's been some change in the food bank and food pantry and anti-hunger movement to be more involved in just the kind of advocacy you're talking about. I think there's more and more understanding that charity and justice are not mutually exclusive. And, the introducers tonight, the first two speakers tonight, arguably are the two leading anti-hunger organizations in the state, both of which talked about the advocacy they do, said specifically, we are not the answer. Kristen from Good Shepherd said that straight out. And I'm just wondering if there's been a shift. We've been doing this work a long time, and, there's always going to be the small pantries in the basement of the churches run by, elderly people who are trying to do good work, and, they don't want to get involved in public policy. They don't. Well, we're seeing that change a little bit, but I've also seen just in the last 10 years, a lot of the traditional charity organizations say exactly what Kristen and Donna said tonight, we're not enough, we're not the answer. So I'm just wondering if some of your assumption is from 20 years ago when the food bank
No, I don't think it's from 20 years ago. I think that yes, I will agree there has been shifts have taken place, and I do know, and you'll certainly see in the Northeast perhaps a more progressive attitude toward
But even Feeding America has a whole robust advocacy mm-hmm. effort. Is it perfect? No. Is it enough? No. Do they have Fortune 100 company people clearly running the board? Yeah, but they have.
Well, but are they fighting for to increase the minimum wage? You know, how are they out there dealing with health care issues? I think, you know, they're taking a few tentative steps in that direction, but I don't think they're pushing hard enough. I visited a large food bank, it was the major food bank for central Louisiana, and they were doing incredibly good work with respect to starting community gardens and community farms in their area. They were essentially working very closely with their clients to make sure they were enrolling in the SNAP program. But then as I kept doing more research, they're also doing more help, providing more healthy food. As I was doing research with other groups in the area, I found that nobody felt they were working with anybody else. They were working by themselves. Now, I'm not saying that's the case here. And you may be doing a great job of collaborating with others. But I also find that unless there's, what percentage of the budget is devoted to advocacy? What percentage of the budget is devoted to collaborating with other organizations? What indeed are the major issues, public policy issues, anti-poverty issues such as minimum wage and health care that they're working on? I mean, I feel that who else could do a better job of this kind of work than food banks, because they are the most recognized, if not the most recognized nonprofit organization in many communities. They're certainly the most recognized food organization in communities. In other words, no one is better positioned to push for this change than food banks are. And so I'm going to keep pushing them to move in that direction. And I'm really happy that there is progress being made. I'm really happy that there is progress being made. But we have a lot more to do.
I'm going to go in the back and then I'll come back to you.
Hi, Mark. Hi. My name is Amara. I am actually from Hartford, Connecticut. I'm currently a farmer, but have done a lot of work in urban agriculture and food justice in Hartford. Mm-hmm. I kind of want to push back a little bit and say, I think when we talk about the food system as being broken, I would argue that it's functioning kind of how it was designed, and that's sort of what is problematic. We talk about all these like big players and having conflicts of interest, both being a lobbyist for the same kind of protection agency they're sort of fighting for. So I guess my question is, on the federal level, there's a lot of issue there, and that we need to kind of dismantle some of those systemic problems. But is the lower hanging fruit working within our local kind of purview? Is that the best approach when we're trying to deal with kind of tackling this much, much larger beast?
What would you define as the low hanging fruit?
I mean these local spheres, like electing people in our local kind of communities to represent these voices, and hoping that eventually we build up enough of a critical mass to kind of focus on the federal level. But I guess, yeah, lower hanging fruit being the local community.
Well, I mean, I think that would be a good place to start. I mean, if we were the area where I am the most hopeful these days is with cities, right at the local level, cities and counties and government at that level. I think that's the area where, that we can see the most change occur. And I think if there was low-hanging fruit, that's where I'd say it is. It's not right now at the federal level. I was going to say something about somebody being hanged at the national level, but I'll avoid that. Anyway, the point is that I do think that that's where we need to be doing work. And I'm not sure if that's what you're asking here, but if whether it's electing mayors or city councilmen or county, I don't know what your county elected officials are called, county commissioners, and starting to build up some of the policies and responses at that level, and then begin to unite those cities around the country to try to have a bigger voice at the state level and in Washington. To me, that's where, you know, that's where the good work is happening. I showed you a slide about a survey, it went over quickly, but a survey done by Michigan State University of communities around the country. And the incredible number of communities that now have some kind of food policies have done comprehensive, there's actually about 200 cities that have actually done comprehensive food plans or food assessments. Cities are where they are increasing the minimum wage. Cities are where are the ones who are trying to tax sugary soft drinks. It's a hotbed of action right now, and I don't know any other sort of level of government or any other sector where we have the opportunity to make that much progress. Now, we can't stop there, and that can't be the only story. I mean, because we have to go beyond it. But I do think that's, you know, if you're looking for a place to do some good work, I would be targeting your cities and your counties and your local government overall.
Hi, Mark. Hi. Chris Hall Weaver. I work with farmers and food producers up in Aroostook County, way up northern
Maine.
And I didn't know about that FRAC, but I do, and I have been studying a little bit about Feeding America, and it sounds like the same cast of characters, big ag, corporate America, funding these organizations. So I look at it as they're the ones that got us in this trouble in the first place. So why do we think corporate American big ag can help us solve hunger? So my idea, I'd like your feedback on, is, especially with Maine, where we are geographically, why can't we wean Good Shepherd off of Feeding America and have Maine philanthropy step up to the plate?
It sounds like an idea worth exploring. I don't have the answer, but I do think that would be, you know, I think they are already moving in that direction, and I think that is a direction I'd encourage. And so what are the obstacles to doing more of that? That's what I'd encourage you to pursue it. You know, one thing I've always admired about the food movement in general is the way that it comes along. I mean, whether you're talking food banks, food pantries, farmers markets, farm to school, the energy and the enthusiasm among the people involved in those things is remarkable. People really care about food. I mean, this food movement is the most exciting place for anyone to be doing any kind of social change work these days, in my opinion. And, you know, I think there's all kinds of good reasons why we're enthusiastic about food. Some of them are really obvious. But, as I was that 19-year-old in Lewiston, Maine, 100 years ago, you know, that's where I was excited, because social change could take place with food, and it could take place at a local level, and it could take place with local projects, and anybody could come along and start something. But, you know, we need to move beyond that energy, and we need to say, all right, how can we work together, do more of that, and let's understand the causes of these problems better than we understand them today. You know, change is like, some of this stuff is really uncomfortable. I mean, talking about having to make a big change in the way you run your program and who you work with, that can be some of the kind of gut-wrenching, discomforting kind of things, stressful things that you can go through. You know, but my own therapist told me that, change is a precursor. I mean, discomfort is a precursor to change. So I need to be able to embrace that discomfort. So I think, your idea is certainly worth pursuing.
Hey, we have time for maybe two or three more, so.
Hi, I'm Jan Bindestani. I'm the advocacy director at Preble Street. I actually also was a labor organizer for about 10 years. I organized with food service workers and janitors all up and down the East Coast. And I really agree with you on your analysis about wealth and inequality in the United States, and that hunger is a symptom of the larger issue of poverty. But for the sake of dialogue, I also really disagree with you about the need to change the SNAP program to require SNAP participants to purchase healthy food, mm-hmm. because I see in them as kind of a disconnect when we're talking about changing structures to fix income and wealth inequality, but then also targeting the behavior of people living in poverty rather than thinking about larger structures of food systems that privilege sugary or unhealthy food. So why the focus on changing the behaviors of people living in poverty rather than thinking about the structural ways we could change the food system to privilege healthy food on a more universal and equitable scale?
I advocate for both. Okay, that's the answer. But the other part of this is that another one of these things that we forget is that we're the only country in the developed world that that places such a significant amount of attention and money on food as part of our social safety net. You know, they don't have SNAP programs in Europe. They don't have, you know, they're not spending $100 billion plus a year on this, like 15 or 16 different USDA food programs. Each one of those food programs has their own story, part of which I, you know, gave you a tiny little historical footnote to earlier in my presentation. So my larger concern is that we have become very dependent and very used to food programs as a way to address all the shortcomings of our society. And why, if we're going to, I mean, yes, poverty and providing, you know, a good, effective social welfare system for this country should be the first priority. It would be like if you started from zero, you know, ground zero, I don't think you'd have the same configuration of programs and approaches that we have now. Having said that, if we have to take it as a given, at least for the next decade or two, I would like to see those programs used as effectively as possible to ensure the public health. Because as we see, the health figures, when it comes to lower income people and SNAP recipients and those who are food insecure, those health problems are severe, much more severe than the general population. So if we were to make some changes, you know, and it isn't just saying you can't do something. I'm not in favor generally of saying that you can't take your SNAP benefit and not use it for something. I'd be much more interested in saying, I'd like you to use your SNAP benefit for something, you know, and we could begin to restructure the programs around a much more positive message. We don't do very much of that. We have the SNAP Ed program. I feel there's some shortcomings with that, and it's not enough, certainly, in comparison to the need. So I think that I would be looking at how to effectively incentivize the SNAP program. And honestly, the anti-hunger organizations like FRAC, haven't been interested in that. You know, it's like, this is the way it is, this is the way it's been, and we're not really interested in making any changes. I think that's really unfortunate.
Hi, Mark. My name is Laura Mills. I'm a student here at USM. And this year is my first exposure to the whole food system, everything. It was my first time taking a class with the food studies program. And one thing that I think shocked me the most and that I think took a lot of my classmates by surprise is that the power on top are these companies that are the commodity crop companies that make their money off of that. And then I go and see that though that's the food that is given as available for the people that need it. And just coming from a kid or someone that's on a smaller level, like I feel like it's just an ongoing kind of cycle, and it makes me kind of concerned for my future because I like want to make a difference, and I feel like we all do on a small scale, but how do you go against a company that is doing that when it's not only the company that's doing that, but it's like the lobbyists behind them? Like, yeah, you're like, our votes count, but if they're the ones with the money and they're the ones with the power and they're these big companies, like, how do you make a change? Like, how do you make the small change to make it happen?
You don't quit. That's the first thing. Don't quit. And just because they're bigger than you and they have more money is not a reason to stop trying to do something. And, you know, as I've said earlier, it is doing something. It's starting somewhere. It's finding some place where you think you can be effective. And that's part of the reason that we have a lot of the programs and projects that we have, is because people feel like that's something tangible they can get their hands on and do it. But then you start thinking about it, trying to educate others. It's bringing other people along so that they get it too. They get this analysis that you just, just offered. And you look for opportunities to keep making changes. Now, we do have a whole bunch of new programs that came out of USDA that came from advocates over the years. And, they're making these connections that haven't been made in the past. We're seeing changes in the minimum wage laws across, again, they're usually at the local level, city levels. So, we are pushing back. Times change, but sometimes we take two steps forward, sometimes we take a step back. But, echo Martin Luther King Jr., I'd say that it's, the arc of history bends toward justice. And I think the arc of history bends toward finding solutions to these problems. So I'm just happy you're doing it, that you're interested. And that's what we need to have more of.
Okay. I'm very sorry to say this, but we have to do a hard stop here the next couple of minutes. So I'd like to invite you to thank our speaker tonight.
Thank you.
And I just want to make a couple of brief closing remarks. I want to thank the student. Tell me your name again. Yeah.
Laura Mills.
Laura Mills for that thought, because I think that you summed up better tonight. I think what we came here to learn about couldn't be said better. I just wanted to make a couple of quick closing remarks. It's great to still see 75 people here after almost 2 hours. Shows a lot of vigor for the subject. The first thing I wanted to say is just to say the obvious, which is that we're representative of an academic program here on campus with all the information that you would need about us out there on a table. But I just wanted to highlight the fact that these are the kinds of discussions that take place in our classrooms every day of the week here at USM, the Food Studies program. And in particular, in the coming spring, so right now we have an undergraduate minor, but we're adding a graduate professional certificate that should be approved sometime in the spring. We have a couple courses in the spring that dig deep into these subjects, including one on hunger and poverty in Maine. And Dr. Cheryl Laz of the Sociology Department has graciously thrown herself into a really big project to build a great course that will be available for both graduates and undergraduate students on this very subject, as well as a food systems, U.S. food system policy and planning course taught by Jamie Picardi, one of our new faculty. And I want to finish with my own thoughts, just to take advantage of the stage here for a second, because I've spent 40 years thinking about the way in which the American economic and political system works as a political economist. And I've spent much of the last 15 years researching and writing about the history of conservative and liberal political movements in the United States over the last 100 years, because the bottom line that we're hearing tonight is that as much work can be done by these charitable organizations, there's a fundamental place for public policy that we can't leave aside. My own experience teaching students here for the longest time is that students say, I really don't want to talk about politics because it just makes me uncomfortable. But I think that discomfort is something that we all have to face. What I'm most struck by on this issue that I didn't really think about 3 years ago, but I think about now, is this, which is that in 1970-71, when Richard Nixon was our Republican president, we had a national consensus that dealing with ameliorating and ending poverty was something that was a goal of both Republican and Democratic parties. 40 years later, where are we? The Republican Party only wants to talk about poverty in terms of blaming victims and stigmatizing people who are supposedly gaming the system and taking advantage of regular taxpayers. And the Democratic Party has completely run away from a frank discussion about the existence of poverty on a large scale in the country and actually doing something about it. All you hear from Democratic candidates at the national level is working middle class families, which is really trying to sanitize the issue of poverty out of it. So if there's one thing that we can take into 2018, if you're passionate about this particular issue, is an insistence that the things that we discussed about here tonight get discussed on a state level, that both parties have a moral obligation to address the fact that poverty is real, and that people are in poverty for structural reasons that are beyond their individual control, and that it can only be by bringing our voices to the debate at the state level for who we elect and the policies that they secure that will actually make a difference. So on that, thank you.